withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. God, receive our worship. Withholding nothing. Thank you, God. Withholding nothing.
One more time.
Withholding nothing.
Come on, we're telling the Lord today we're withholding nothing. Everything I am, everything I have to be, God, I give it to you. I'm withholding nothing because, God, you are my everything. In you I live, I move, and I have my very being. Come on, can we just bless the name of the Lord because he's worthy? Because he's worthy? Because he's worthy? Worthy to be praised. Come on, I don't know about you, but I was glad when they said unto me, come on, let us go to the house of the Lord. The house of the Lord is wherever you find yourself today. It may be in your living room. It may be in your bedroom. It may be in the parking lot. But we were glad when they said unto us, let us go into the house of the Lord that I might bless his holy name. Come on, somebody. We've come to bless him. We've come to exalt him. We've come to lift up his holy name. Yay! Hallelujah. 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 Oh, this is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I am glad to be with the people of God this morning, with you online and with you right here in person at 5184 Singleton Way. We bless the name of God this morning, that God has made it possible for us to gather together virtually and in person as we worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. And isn't this a wonderful day that the Lord has given us? Amen. We bless God. The beautiful weather that God has provided. And I am so grateful to God because God is indeed our keeper. This has been a tumultuous week. It has been a tumultuous month. It has been a tumultuous quarter. But God has been faithful. God has been faithful. And I believe that that is why everything that has breath ought to praise the Lord. I don't know if you see what my shirt says. My shirt says that some people are saying, I can't breathe. So if you realize that the breath is being choked out of some people, then everything that hath breath ought to praise the Lord. Everything that can inhale and exhale ought to give God glory. Everybody who's still taking in some air and putting out some air ought to give God praise. Come on, somebody. I've come to bless the Lord. I've come to exalt his name. I've come to tell the Lord, hallelujah, because the Lord is good. Hallelujah, and his faithfulness endures forever. Listen, there was a word from the Lord this morning that I would like to share with you. And I'd ask you this morning if you would turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew chapter number 9. The Gospel of Matthew chapter 9. We're going to start our reading at verse 35. And then we're going to skip over into chapter 10. And so just kind of follow along with me as we move forward. And again, I want to say good morning to all of you all who are watching us online this morning. I posted something a little earlier, said take a selfie today. Show us where you are. You may be in the parking lot. You may be in your living room. You may be in your kitchen. But take a selfie today and just post it. Let us know where you are that we can once again be together. We're in different spots, but we're all together. And so we want to bless the Lord for you this morning. And again, thank you so much. For those of you who are here in the parking lot and those of you who are watching us virtually, we say good morning to you. The Gospel of Matthew chapter 9, we're going to start our reading at verse 35. This is what it says. It says, Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Chapter 10, verse 1. Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. Drop down to verse 5. Then these 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or into any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. And as you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received and freely you will give. Indulge me for a few more verses. Jot down to verse 16. Jesus says to the 12, I am sending you out like sheep among wolves. Therefore, be as shrewd as snakes and innocent as doves. Be on your guard, for you will be handed over to the local councils and be flogged in the synagogues. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. So, verse 26, so do not be afraid of them. For there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, nothing hidden that will not be made known. Verse 28, do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Amen, amen, and amen. As the Lord shall lead this morning, we want to speak on the topic of WWJD. What would Jesus do? Let's pray. Father, we bless you this morning for allowing us to gather together that we might worship you in spirit and in truth. We thank you, God, for your word is good. It's good for instruction, it's good for reproof, it's good for correction, it's good for teaching. And so God, today, teach us your word. And God, allow us to open our hearts to hear what you want to say, that we won't just be hearers, but Lord, that we'll be doers. And as you pull those disciples to you that day, pull us closer to you today. Lord, that we might follow behind you and walk in your steps and do the very things that you have done to the end that your name will be glorified. We thank you for this occasion. We thank you for gathering us together. And God, now I pray for the anointing for preaching. God, that your word would go forth and not come back void. We claim the victory in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and amen. What would Jesus do? Well, if you are of a certain age, I know you've heard that before because it was a standard trope years back. And it was always lifted up as an invitation to imagine what Jesus would do if he lived in our time and in our culture. What behaviors, what course of action would he take if he found himself in our specific situations? Understanding that Jesus was never cut off in traffic, but if he was, what would he have done? Jesus was never bullied on social media, but if he was, what would he have done? How would the young man Jesus deal with the hookup culture? What would he put on his Instagram to not appear prideful? How would teenage Jesus handle the pressure of his peers? And what would black Jesus do if somebody called him the N-word? WWJD was asked with the understanding that while specific contemporary situations that we deal with on a daily basis may not be found in the biblical text, the principles that we can use to deal with them are certainly found and can be found by watching how Jesus navigated his life and then taking the opportunity to apply those principles to our contemporary lives. And so for the believer, for the follower of Christ, this is what we must always do. For I have heard people say, it's so different now. We've never seen it so bad. I mean, our young people are living in a world that we've never lived in. We can't apply 20th century solutions to 21st century problems. And I would agree in somewhat, but while the 20th century solutions may not work on 21st century problems, I believe if we look back a little further, we will be able to find a solution to our 21st century problems. If we begin to look back a little further, if we begin to look back maybe perhaps to not the 20th century, but to the first century, if we look back to the first century Palestine, I believe we'll be able to find some solutions to our 21st century world. Because if we look to how Jesus taught in the first century, we'll find the answers that we need. And so as I look around and as we endure this global pandemic that is not over, as the eyes of the world are focused on the ongoing and pervasive racism in our country, as the murder of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and so many other black men and black women at the hands of law enforcement has reignited a call for police reform, and as each of us deal with our own particularities of life, I think it is a good time to re-ask the question, what in the world would Jesus do? And I believe that this text before us this morning will give us some insight on the principles that Jesus would use to handle the affairs of our day. So if you were to take a look at this Matthewan text, you will know that it was written primarily to a Jewish audience. Yes, Jesus is fully engaged in ministry. By the time we get to chapter 9, he's already preached the Sermon on the Mount in chapters 5 through 7. And now beginning in chapter 8, he is demonstrating that he has authority over the forces of evil and chaos. He cleanses a leper. He heals a centurion's servant. He rebukes the wind and calms the sea. He heals a paralytic man, stops the hemorrhaging of blood of a woman who's been sick for 12 long years, and then he raises the daughter of a synagogue official from the dead. The eyes of the blind are being opened and people are being set free from the demonic spirits that had held them bound. The text says that Jesus is traveling from city to village, all the while preaching the gospel, all the while proclaiming the good news of the kingdom. He is proclaiming that the kingdom has come, that God's way of doing things has arrived. And as he went from place to place, Jesus observed the state of his people. He saw their condition and he saw their plight. He realized that among his people, a lot of people were dealing with illness and disease, despite the Roman claims to have blessed the world with good health. The ceaseless labor, the constant anxiety, coupled with an unhealthy diet, caused many of them to fall sick with maladies and disorders. And when he began to look at his people, he reflected that many of them were mere peasants. And they stayed poor because even though they were working constantly 2 and 3 jobs, the majority of what they produced was taken by heavy taxes imposed by the Roman government and by the greedy and wealthy landowners to whom they paid rent. So the rich in the empire were getting richer on the backs of the populous poor. There was hunger in the streets. I'm talking about first century Palestine. Malnutrition and food insecurity was prevalent as they struggled to make ends meet. And as if this was not enough, many of them found themselves under the influence of demonic forces that had colluded together, that had co-joined to keep them down and to keep them bound. And so Jesus looked at this crowd. He looked at his own people and he declared that his people were perishing. He declared that his people were dying because of the exploitation of the unjust Roman empire. And it was at this crowd that Jesus was looking that day. When he surveyed the crowd, he looked at the crowd, and the text says that as he looked at them in chapter 9, at the end of chapter 9, it says, as he looked at them, it says Jesus had compassion for them. He looked at them and knowing that they were in the shape they were in because of the constant harassment and the oppression of the empire, and Jesus said they were helpless. Jesus said they were like sheep without a shepherd. A sheep without a shepherd is in trouble. Yes, see, a sheep without a shepherd has no one to protect them. A sheep without a shepherd has no one to guide them. And Jesus, upon observing this group, said to the disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. What he's saying is the need is great. The problems are many. The opportunities for impact are abundant, but we don't have enough laborers. We don't have enough laborers to handle the work. The harvest is sure, but more workers are needed to bring in the harvest. And so as Jesus declares that we must do something, he tells the disciples, listen, we got to do something about this. We must take action. And so he tells the disciples to pray. He says, pray therefore for more laborers. And little do they know that they would become the answer to their own prayers. Because as soon as Jesus tells them to pray, the next thing Jesus does is Jesus summons the 12 disciples to gather around him. And he tells them that they are now being given the power. They are now being given the authority that they need to do something to help the people in the crowd. They, along with Jesus, have seen the plight of the people. They, along with Jesus, have seen the issues that they are dealing with. And they are now being equipped. Jesus is equipping them with the tools. He's equipping them with what they need to handle the vastness of the needs that will help to bring in the harvest. And Jesus is going now. He's getting ready to send them out. I know I'm giving y'all a whole lot of background, but y'all need to get this. Because see, Jesus has seen it. He's shared it with the disciples. He's given them power and authority, and now he's sending them out. The text says he equips them with the power and the authority to do all the things that they have just witnessed him doing in chapters 8 and 9. In Jesus' name, they would be able to lay hands on the sick and see them recover. In Jesus' name, they'll be able to lay hands on the dead and see them rise. In Jesus' name, they will be able to cast out demons and send them back to the pits of hell. And Jesus tells them to go, and I want you to do what you've seen me doing among the Jewish nation. He says, all I want you to do is what you've seen me do. They are to go, and he tells them, and listen, I don't want you to go to the Gentile region. I don't want you to go to where the Samaritans live. He says, but I only want you to go to the lost sheep of Israel. I want you to hear this. As Jesus surveyed the land, he saw the condition of his people. And he saw that Israelite lives were being snuffed out at the hands of the Roman Empire. That Israelite lives were being exploited by the enormous barriers that had been erected to stop them from achieving economic success. That Israelite lives were succumbing to illness because of the lack of access to quality health care. That Israelite lives were being forced to live in substandard housing because of greedy and wealthy landowners. And he tells them, I'm giving you power, and I'm giving you authority, and I'm sending you to go see about Israelite lives. I'm sending you to go and improve the lives of these people, to go and proclaim the kingdom of God to these people. I am sending you to minister only to the lost sheep of Israel because Israelite lives matter. When Jesus sees the condition of the crowd, when Jesus surveyed the situation in the street, Jesus was filled with compassion, sympathetic concern for the suffering of others. And right then and there, he decided that he would give an opportunity for the disciples to help him meet the needs of the crowd, to join him in this important work. For the harvest was plentiful, but the laborers were few. And my brother and my sister, in 2020, Jesus is still concerned with the condition of the crowd. Jesus has not stopped surveying the situations in the street. And I want you to know that Jesus is still filled with compassion. Jesus still cares, and Jesus is still affected by the suffering and the anguish and the adversity of the people. Jesus sees that the knee of oppression has been on the neck of the people in the crowd for over 400 years. Jesus sees the systematic way that the empire has denied wealth accumulation of the crowd through unjust hiring policies, through discriminatory housing and lending practice, through unequal education. In 2020, the Lord sees the disparities in the healthcare system that have resulted in lower mortality rates for blacks than whites. The Lord sees that in COVID-19 has impacted those in the crowd in more significant ways. The Lord sees that for every $1 earned by a white man, a black man only earns 69 cents, and a black woman only earns 60 cents. The Lord sees the injustices faced by the people in the crowd at the hands of arresting officers. The Lord sees the injustice faced by the crowd by prosecutors and judges. The Lord sees those in the crowd who are hungry and hurting. The Lord sees those in the crowd who are weary and worn out. The Lord sees those who are in the crowd who are lost and depleted. The Lord sees those in the crowd who are being bound by sin. And the Lord sees those who are despondent. The Lord sees those in the crowd. I want you to know today that if you're in the crowd, the Lord sees you. The Lord sees the condition of your plight. The Lord knows what you're going through. The Lord sees those who are yet praying and are believing, but are still exasperated and done. The Lord sees those who are fasting and praying and reading and believing, but who are still in the struggle against the empire. The Lord sees those who are in the crowd. And so the question is, in the year of 2020, what would Jesus do? WWJD, you ought to put that right down there in the comments. WWJD, in 2020, what would Jesus do? And if we are to follow those first century principles, then in turn, what should we do? And I believe that what Jesus would do now is exactly what Jesus did then. Jesus invited his followers to have compassion on the crowd and to join him in the work. That's what he did. He said, I need you to look on the crowd and have the same compassion that I have. In first century Palestine, Jesus mobilized his followers to be about his mission, to proclaim the good news of the kingdom, to cure every sickness and disease, to take authority over unclean spirits, to cast down and to cast out demonic forces that are oppressing and threatening to overtake God's people. And I want you to know that Jesus is calling his followers to mobilize today. The call today is for followers of Christ to reclaim the mission of Jesus, to dedicate and to devote our lives to doing what Jesus did. To doing what Jesus did for the crowd, to look on with care, to look on with concern, to have compassion that moves us to action. I want you to know it's not enough just to put a post on your Facebook page. He says compassion means action. He says to take care of the crowd. So what does that look like in 2020? What does a commitment to carry the gospel to the crowd mean? What must we do to be successful in our work? And what does it look like to be faithful to our mission? And I want you to understand, it means exactly the same thing that it meant in first century Palestine. It means if we're going to be faithful to our mission, if we're going to do what Jesus did, then we're going to have to, number one, we're going to have to answer the call. You see, the call has gone forth. We've all heard it. But we must answer the call. Because every follower of Jesus has received a commission to take the gospel to the world. Every believer has a call. Every believer has a call. You have a mission to fulfill. I'm not talking about being called to preach or being called to evangelize. I'm talking about the call, the universal call of every believer of Jesus Christ. It is to take the gospel to the world. You've got a mission to fulfill. Our first call, Jesus calls us to be with him, to be with him, to spend time in the divine presence, to study, to learn, so we can be like Christ. I want you to see that these first disciples, they did not volunteer for this assignment. They were commissioned. They were sovereignly called, and with the assignment comes the power and the authority that they need to carry it out. The Lord equipped them with everything that was needed to fulfill the ministry and the mission. Their mission was to go to the crowd, the lost sheep of Israel, and proclaim the good news. The good news was that when God's kingdom arrives, it disrupts the status quo. When God's kingdom arrives, everything around it must change. When God's kingdom breaks forth, our lives can change because of the transformative power of the good news. You see, their mission was to take the message to a particular audience. The message of the moment was for those who were in the crowd that Jesus knew were being oppressed by the Roman Empire. The mission of the moment was for the disciples to stay in Israel. They were not to go to the Gentiles. They were not to go to the region of the Samaritans. And yes, those lives matter too. But right now, the focus of the moment was on the lost sheep of Israel. Jesus was sending his followers on a specific mission to a particular people with a particular message at this moment because these lives mattered. Jesus had himself had shown us that all lives were important. I mean, he had already healed a centurion's servant. He had already gone into Gentile regions and delivered those who had been bound up by devils. And at the end of the gospel, right before he goes to sit back on the right hand of the Father, these same disciples, as well as all disciples, that is when we will receive their commission to take the gospel into all the world. Jesus has already showed us that all lives matter to him. But he tells them even then that they will start in Jerusalem, they will go to Judea, and then they will go to the uttermost parts of the world. The disciples will be scattered and they will take the gospel into many regions. Peter will be sent to share the gospel in the house of Cornelius, a Gentile. Paul, a Jew, will carry the gospel and establish churches all over the Roman Empire. But in this moment, Jesus' focus was on this crowd, the crowd that was being oppressed. Jesus wanted his followers to see them like he did. He wanted them to have the same concern that he had. Jesus wanted them to have the same compassion that he did. Jesus wanted them to focus on the lost sheep of Israel and take the message of the kingdom to them. So know this, if we are to fulfill our mission as followers of Christ, we must answer the call. God wants us to open our eyes to the plight of the people in the crowd. God wants us to ask like Marvin, what's going on? What is the condition of the people? What are the needs in the crowd? Are they hungry? Feed them. Are they sick? Go see about them. Are they in prison? Visit them. Are they being mistreated? Help free them. Are they being harassed? Stand up for them. Are they in danger? Cover them. Are they being silent? Speak up for them. Are they bound? Dismantle the systems that are holding them captive. Do you understand? Jesus says, go and see about the crowd. Every disciple that Jesus chose was unique. They came in all different kinds of backgrounds. They were rich, they were poor, they were government officials, they were common fishermen, they were from the city, they were from the countryside. But regardless of who they were, they all had the same mission. Every one of them had the exact same mission. They all were responsible for taking care of the crowd. And so I don't care who you are today. I don't care what you say your personality is like. I don't care what you tell me God did and did not give you in terms of spiritual gifts. All of us have the exact same mission, to carry the gospel into all the world, to take care of the crowd. See, you may be able to cash app some money. You may be able to cash app money for food, and you may be able to pray for deliverance. You may be able to drive somebody to a doctor's appointment, and you may be able to make and donate masks to the vulnerable. But whatever it is, you've got to take your part in taking care of the crowd. And we, who are both in the crowd and followers of Jesus, we can just reach out and lend a hand wherever we are. Where you see sickness, try to bring healing. Where you see demonic forces of evil keeping the crowd in bondage to substandard education, to predatory lending, where you see the crowd in bondage to voter suppression, to environmental racism, you've just got to work where you are to help set people free. Where we see them bound in sin, we got to work to set them free. Where they're bound up in hopelessness and despair, we got to work to set them free. Where they're bound up in certainty, where they're bound up in rage, where they're bound up in anger, where they're bound up and tied up in the world system, we've got to work to set them free. We must give them the message. The message of the gospel is the kingdom of God is at hand. That God's kingdom has come. And when the kingdom comes, it shifts everything. When the kingdom comes, the empire must bow. When the kingdom comes, the sick are made well, the dead are brought to life, and those that are bound are set free. He says, take the message to the crowd, because the lives in the crowd matter, because black lives matter. If we're going to be faithful, if we're going to be faithful to this mission, to this call to take the gospel, you got to answer the call. You got to realize that you're not excluded. You don't have to do it the way I do it, but you're not excluded. You must take the gospel into all the world. Answer the call. But not only do you have to answer the call, but you need to arm yourself with courage. You need to arm yourself with courage. Because whenever we make a commitment to do the things of God, you need to know it's going to take courage. Because a commitment to one thing will ultimately mean conflict with something else. So we must have courage, because a commitment always produces pushback. See, Jesus warns his disciples right here in this text. He lets them know, listen, I know what I'm telling you to do, but this is going to be a hard road to hoe. This is going to be a hard road ahead for you. He tells them this because when they answer the call, he knows that people are going to stand against them. He tells them that because they answer the call, because they take the message of the kingdom to the crowd, that everybody ain't going to like this. As a matter of fact, they should expect pushback from all different kinds of places. He said, you should expect pushback from your own families. He says right there in the text, right there in chapter 10, he says, brother will come against brother. He says, and father will come against child. He says, not only should you expect pushback in your family, but you should expect pushback from the leading religious voices of the day. He says, they will decimate you. They will scandalize you. They will scandalize your reputation, he says, in the aisles and in the altars of their synagogues. He says, and not only should you face pushback from your families and from religious authorities, but you should certainly face pushback from government authorities. He says, because whenever you are proposing something that will upset the apple cart, whenever you are proposing something that will cause a disruption in their privilege, the powers that be will not be happy. To say that the Lord's kingdom has come was to say that the religious structures of the moment were somehow inadequate. It was to say that they were somehow insufficient. To advocate for the overhaul of a taxation system would mean a loss of revenue for the government. It would mean a loss of revenue for those who receive kickbacks to maintain the status quo. To heal people of all manner of disease would mean a loss of revenue for Big Pharma. It would mean a loss of revenue for the medical conglomerates. And so Jesus wants them to know that because they are proclaiming that the kingdom has come, that trouble will be on the horizon. As a matter of fact, don't be surprised, he says, if you're hated by all kinds of people simply for speaking up in my name. They will hate you for simply speaking up for the crowd. They will hate you. He said, because listen here, they hated me first. Be not dismayed, do not be afraid, because they hated me first, so you are in good company. They persecuted me first. They called me all kinds of names first. So think it not strange when the same thing happens to you. Jesus says, yet you must not have fear of them. I know that I am sending you out as sheep among wolves, but don't be afraid. I want you to have the courage and to be wise as a serpent and to be harmless as a dove. He says, but I want you to understand that even though I'm sending you out like this, I want you to just keep doing the work and keep trusting that the Spirit of God will fill your mouth with the words that you need when you need it. He says, I want you to trust the Spirit of God to direct your steps away from danger and into places of safety. Trust the Spirit of God to prove what you need every step of the way. He tells them, have courage. Do not fear those who can only kill the body. He says, but fear God, who has control of your soul. He says, because the God who sees, the God who knows, is the God who cares. And if you stand up for God, then God will stand up for you. He tells the disciples, God's got you. And in this age, in this place, in 2020, I want you to know that whenever you stand up for God, whenever you stand up for the crowd, you can expect conflict. When you stand for righteousness, when you proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, which has the power to transform, expect resistance. Because the devil will never roll over and release the captive. But you gotta learn how to stand and push anyhow. I believe it was Dr. MLK that said, freedom is never voluntarily given up by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed. And I know that we love MLK now. We love Dr. Martin Luther King now. But back then, black preachers were telling him to stop stirring up trouble. Back then, white preachers were telling him to be patient. Oh, they can't stop talking about MLK now, his dream and all of that. But then, his dream didn't stop them from assassinating him. He received pushback. You see, Paul preached the gospel and he was put in prison. Peter preached the gospel and they hung him upside down. John preached the gospel and they banished him to the Isle of Patmos. And Jesus preached the gospel and they crucified him on an old rugged cross. So don't be surprised when you received pushback. And I want to tell you that in this here city of Virginia Beach, the African-American pastors in this city, we've been standing up for economic equality. We've been calling for a blackout for the month of June. We've been telling people to keep your money in your pocket or spend your money with black businesses. We've told people, don't spend your money in Virginia Beach Town Center. Don't take your dollars down to the ocean front. We have been proclaiming the gospel that the kingdom of God is at hand, and therefore everything must change. And I want you to hear it from me. It's causing conflict. Slanderous accusations are being heralded. Pushback from business owners is happening. And on last Sunday morning, somebody called one of our sister churches and threatened to burn the church down. Conflict and pushback. All because we have looked at the crowd and had compassion. All because we have looked at the crowd and declared that we can't go keep going on like we're going on. All because we have committed to carrying out the mission of Jesus Christ. All because we are declaring that change gotta come. All because we are saying that black lives matter. And I want you to understand that all over the world, people have looked at the crowd and they have shown compassion. They are marching in the streets in London. They are marching in the streets in Australia. They are marching in solidarity with Black Lives Matter crowd from Beirut to Berlin, from Nigeria to Mexico. They have looked at the crowd and with compassion, they are proclaiming the message that the cruel force of the empire must be broken, that the kingdom of God must prevail, that the kingdom of God will set the captives free, that the kingdom of God says that justice must roll down like a river and righteousness like a mighty stream, that the kingdom of God says that all people are created in the image of God and such must be treated with the same respect and with equal treatment under the law. And I told you last week, and I'm gonna tell you again, it matters where you stand. It matters where you stand in this moment, because God wants us to stand. Stand where we can see the crowd. Stand where you can identify with the crowd. Stand where you can stand with compassion. Stand with courage and ask God what God would have you do in this moment. To stand with God with your unique set of skills, with your unique set of gifts, with your unique talents, with your heart, with your passion, with your experience. Stand with God and ask God what God would have you do in this moment. How God would have you to minister to the crowd, because where you stand can make a difference in the lives of the people of the crowd. And when we make a commitment to God, when we make a commitment to have compassion on the crowd, when we make a commitment to take up the mission of God, we must know that it's going to cost you something. There's going to be a cost to pay. Some of these disciples would walk away from their families. Some of these disciples would have to leave their very professions. Some of them would throw away their fish nets and begin to fish for souls. Some of them would now have to worry about being arrested along with this radical man named Jesus. But I want you to understand that even though this group would have to face shame, even though they'd have to face social rejection, even though they'd have to face violence and humiliation, they knew they were going up against the Roman Empire, and the Roman Empire was known to crucify those who threatened their society. They understood that their commitment was costly, but they went on anyhow, because Jesus and his disciples, when he dispatches them into the crowd, Jesus tells them it's going to cost you something. And he tells them to pick up your cross and follow me. He tells them it's going to cost you something, but take up your cross and follow me anyhow. Follow me anyhow. To take up the cross is to refuse to be intimidated into compliance. To take up the cross is to refuse to keep your mouth closed. To take up the cross is to recognize what Jesus recognized, and that is that the power of the empire is limited. That the power of the empire is not almighty. To take up your cross is to realize that trouble don't last always. To take up the cross is to realize that the empire does not have all power. That weeping may endure for a night, or you might go through for a while, but joy still comes in the morning. Joy still comes in the morning. Hallelujah, somebody. To recognize that if God be for you, he's more than the whole world against you. To recognize that God is our helper, that God is our guide, that God is our keeper. To recognize that though the empire wants you to think that they have all power, the empire's power is limited. Because even though the Roman Empire had the power to kill Jesus, they did not have enough power to keep him dead. Hallelujah, somebody. They had enough power to kill him, but they didn't have enough power to keep him in the grave. They could kill the body, but they couldn't touch his soul. And I want you to understand, my beloved, you've got that same power that raised Jesus from the dead, that resurrection power. Yes. That's the same power that God has given us. And so when God sends us out into the world to take care of the crowd, he doesn't send us out powerless. He equips us with the power and the authority that we need to do what he did and even greater works. He has called us to go forth. We are followers of Christ. We are disciples of Jesus. He has filled us with the same compassion, and he's given us the same power. And so on this second Sunday of June in the year of 2020, what would Jesus do? What would Jesus do in the midst of a global pandemic? In the midst of heightened awareness of rampant racism, what would Jesus do? I believe Jesus would recognize the opportunity for harvest. I believe Jesus would recognize that the harvest is plentiful, but it's the laborers that's few. I believe that God would have us to pray. To pray for more laborers. And then even after we pray for more laborers, I believe God would have us to become the answer to our own prayers. that we will become the answer, that we will mobilize, that we realize that you can't sit this one out. It is too important. There is a change in the atmosphere. There is a change coming. It was ushered in with the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And all God wants us to do is to look on the crowd. And because most of us are in the crowd, we simply look out among ourselves and we ask God, what do you want me to do? How can you use me in this hour? This is not the time to point fingers. This is not the time to talk about what anybody else is or is not doing. I know we've seen certain people are marching and you say, that's not me. Certain people are tearing down monuments and you say, for the Lord, that's not me. But God has a part for you in this. And I want you to understand that it is a part of the mission that we've already received. It is a part of proclaiming the gospel. It is saying to the world, the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God declares that everyone is made in the image of God. And as such, not one person is superior over another. And anything that stands against the kingdom of God must come down. Anything, any system, any rule, any policy, any person that stands against the kingdom of God must come down. And what we see in 2020 is a shifting. It's a bringing down of demonic forces that have set themselves up against the kingdom of God. So my brother and my sister, what I'm telling you is answer the call. And what I'm telling you is it's going to require courage. But I want you to understand that God has given us everything we need to carry out this mission. Everything we need to fulfill this call. God has already given it to us. And so now I'm going to do what Jesus said, do. We're gonna pray. Right there, online, I want you to pray with us. Right here in the parking lot, I want you to pray. I want you to pray this prayer. God, show me what you'd have me to do. I may not agree and I may not see eye to eye with what everybody else is doing or has done. Whatever you're doing in this moment, don't do it without me. Whatever you're doing, God, if you're healing in this moment, don't do it without me. If you're saving in this moment, don't do it without me. If you're pulling down injustice in this moment, don't do it without me. Don't leave me out. Show me what you'd have me to do. And then God, open my eyes and my heart. Open my eyes, God, that I can show enough see the crowd, that I can see what my part is, that I can fulfill my call in the way that I've been uniquely created and made, that I can walk in the fullness of who I am to the glory of God. Father, look on nation today. God, you see the upheaval. You see the rioting in the streets. You see the unjust treatment of our brothers and our sisters. You see it, God. Lord, we have endured these things for so long. And God, we're calling to you, and we're asking you, God, to send forth the laborers into the harvest. We're asking you, God, to dispatch us where we need to be. We realize, God, that when Jesus saw it, that he didn't say he was just going to move his hands and make it all go away. He didn't say that he was going to just uproot and tear down in that moment. But God, in that moment, the Lord invited the disciples to help him make it happen. And so, God, today, Lord, we accept the call. We're answering it. But God, we need you to show us what to do. You told those disciples exactly where to go, exactly what to do. You told them what to take and what not to take. You told them, Lord, don't even take a bag. You told them, don't take extra shoes. You told them that when they went into a house, if they didn't receive them, to shake the dust off their feet and turn around and go back out. You told them if they went into one village and they wouldn't hear them, to turn around and go to another village. God, you told them exactly what to do and how to do it. And so, God, we know that just like you did it for the first century disciple, God, you'll do it for the 21st century disciple. And so, God, here we are. Here we stand. We've gotten our orders. We just need to know how to carry them out. So, God, speak to each one of us individually and speak to us collectively, that we would hear your voice and we'll move in obedience to this call. And God, whatever we do, that we won't shrink back, but we'll stand. And after we've done all, we'll still stand, trusting and believing you to use us in this moment for your glory. And now, God, those who are listening to me, those who are praying along with me, not only do we pray for our direction, but God, we pray for those who've not yet received you as their Savior. All of us are praying together. We're believing together that anyone under the sound of the voice of this broadcast, anybody under the sound of this voice out here in this parking lot, God, that they would know that you are the only living God. That they will know that you are our Savior. That you sent your Son, Jesus, to die for us on that cross. That our lives would not be the same, but that our lives would be different. God, that our lives would be transformed by the power of Jesus Christ. That we would no longer be bound to sin. We would no longer be bound to held back by our own proclivities. Lord, we'll no longer have to be bound to the things that try to hold us in. But God, today, you came to set us free. And so, Lord, we thank you that anybody who's listening, God, who's never accepted you as their Savior, but today would be the day that they would declare that they believe that you sent Jesus to the earth, that he lived, that he died, that he was buried, and on the third day he rose. And when he rose with all power in his hand. They would declare today, believe in their heart and confess with their mouth that you raised him from the dead, and today they shall be saved. So right here, right now, if there's one that needs accept Jesus as your Savior, just turn your lights on in the parking lot. If you're watching us online, what we need you to do is just put a heart right there in the comments. If you're looking for a church home, you already know Jesus, but you need a place where you can join in with your brothers and your sisters. Right there, what I want you to do is I want you to put home right there in the comments. If you're looking for a church home, put home. If you want to accept Jesus as your Savior, I want you to put a heart right there in the comments. And if you just want more information about New Jerusalem Ministries, just put NJM right there in the comments, and somebody will get back to you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, whatever.